Good afternoon, everybody. Thank you, Giovanni, for the introduction. As the title of my presentation says, today I'm going to talk about antiferromagnetic terahertz detectors, which has been basically a topic already debated before in the very nice talk of Professor Prokopenko. And in particular, I'm trying to give my a contribution to this topic, showing now the results obtained in collaboration with these co-authors, Ansar Safin, Roman Kimin, and Professor Slavin, who gave us basically a great support in the analytical models. Of course, together with Mario and Giovanni for the numerical simulations. Well, this is the outline of my discussion. I'm focusing on the micromagnetic modeling of antiferromagnetic spintronic devices, presenting both results for terahertz oscillators and detectors. So let's start with the introduction, and in particular, we are dealing with terahertz technology. We already listened about terahertz. We are between microwaves and infrared, from few hundred of gigahertz to few terahertz. Probably this is the last span of the electromagnetic spectrum that has been developed for technological applications. In fact, in the past, only astronomers and chemists were interested in these frequencies, but later terahertz oscillations have turned out very promising for many other fields for I would say three major properties. In fact, terahertz waves are important first because in many materials which block infrared and microwave waves appears transparent in the terahertz region. So these waves can penetrate clothing and polyethylene, polyester, and many other enclosures. Second, as compared to microwaves, terahertz emission enabled to achieve a better quality for imaging. And last, another important property of terahertz emission is its harmlessness with respect to biological entities. So, for instance, with respect to X-rays, they are safe for humans, animals, and plants. For this reason, they are used in imaging, in biomedicine, for instance, for cancer detection, or in security to scan people and bags at security checkpoints. For a lot of reasons, also spintronics, after years working to study the gigahertz oscillations in ferromagnetic materials, moved to terahertz to give its contribution in the proper design of terahertz emitters and, of course, detectors. Well, of course, detections of terahertz is a crucial aspect in terahertz technology. Some scientific results and references can be obtained in these papers by Sidzov and Rogalski. For example, here they start comparing the two main different approaches for the terahertz detection: a direct incurrent detection and a current detection realized by means of heterodyne circuits and the local oscillator. And then they describe the standard approach of thermal and photon terahertz detection, but the realization of terahertz emitters and detectors is a challenge because the frequency here are too high for conventional electronics, and the photon energies are too small for classical optics. So recent studies have focused on novel approaches for the terahertz detection, such as graphene-based terahertz detectors, terahertz detectors with metamaterials, and antiferromagnetic-based terahertz detectors. Well, antiferromagnetism is a property of several materials like oxides, alloys, and metals. The most important property with respect to ferromagnets we know is that they show zero net magnetization at the equilibrium. And just for this reason, in the past, they have not found a lot of technological properties, but for the same reason, for instance, they can be used as reference for sensors. In the case of spintronics, spintronics used a lot anti-ferromagnetic materials. First, for instance, in exchange-biased ferromagnet, anti-ferromagnetic materials, like in one of the device presented by Professor Prokopenko, then antiferromagnetism has been synthesized by using two ferromagnetic layers aligned anti-parallel, and very recently spintronics has focused on the possibility to consider antiferromagnetic materials as the key layers of our device. Actually, those materials hold very important properties for spintronic devices because they are robust against external field. They do not produce a stray field, and this aspect actually leads to a different and more complicated experimental techniques to reveal the magnetization state. But above all, they show ultra-fast dynamics. Actually, we can say that in antiferromagnetic materials, we can obtain those terahertz oscillations as well as gigahertz oscillations are obtained in ferromagnets. When it comes to modeling, antiferromagnetic materials are modeled considering two separate sublattices, of course, aligned antiparallel at equilibrium, but interacting each other via the antiferromagnetic exchange. Under proper circumstances, it is possible to obtain a movement of these magnetization vectors. And in this case, we get a small but non-zero net magnetization, as explained in this paper by Elena Gomonai, who has given a lot of contributions in this field. In this other paper by Slavin, Professor Slavin and Roman Kimin, actually, they predicted this kind of dynamics of the sublattices vectors in the case of an antiferromagnet coupled to an heavy metal, so exploiting the spin-hole effect. Well, and actually, from that paper that was our reference for our micromagnetic modeling, we decided to study a similar spin hole oscillator realized by means of an antiferromagnetic material, which was modeled within plane anisotropy, while the possibility to apply the current at different couples of terminals gave us the possibility to tilt the spin-hole polarization with respect to the easy axis. Since in other papers, they had considered different configurations. This is basically our micromagnetic modeling, where we use two separate Landau-Lifshitz-Dilbert-Slonczewski equations for the two sublattices. Of course, in this case, the main role is played by the exchange field, which plays the main role basically for two aspects. First, it's the term which couples the two sublattices. Otherwise, they would behave basically independently. Second, as we will see in the next slide, the antiferromagnetic resonance frequency is proportional to the exchange contribution. So it is possible to obtain a terahertz oscillation due to the high exchange, the high antiferromagnetic exchange. Well, in this case, I would skip all the details of the exchange field, but it is important to understand that we have three main contributions. The first one is the anti-ferromagnetic coupling, basically the most important term for the anti-ferromagnetic exchange. The second is the standard ferromagnetic exchange. And the third is the non-homogeneous intersublattice exchange, which in our studies has turned out negligible. So in most cases, we considered zero its corresponding constant. So let's move to the study of the antiferromagnetic resonance. Actually, we have studied the antiferromagnetic resonance by varying the intersublattice exchange constant, and we could find numerical results in agreement with modeling, with analytical model developed by Roman Kinin. In this case, we changed the antiferromagnetic exchange by varying the intersublattice constant, the lattice constant, and the lower is the lattice constant, the larger is the antiferromagnetic exchange, and the larger is the antiferromagnetic, the FMR, the frequency at the resonance. But at the same time, we could observe that for a large antiferromagnetic exchange, we get an amplification of the bandwidth, with, which of course has impact also on the detection, on the passive detection, basically. Then, in fact, this is a summary where we can see that at high homogeneous intersublattice exchange, we get higher AFMR, but also larger bandwidth, so reducing the quality factor for the detection. In any case, we will see later the detection. Now, let me spend a few slides on the oscillations, because in 2019 we published our first paper, and it was about the spin-Hall antiferromagnetic oscillator. Here, if we apply a current larger than a threshold value, then the two magnetic vectors basically bend and start rotating around the spin-Hall polarization. We observe a subcritical bifurcation, a subcritical excitation of the dynamics, where the elimination current is lower than the ignition current. The frequency of oscillations increases with the applied frequency, and basically in a large range of with the applied current, sorry, and basically in a large range of currents, it increases linearly. We got very narrow line width corresponding to a very large quality factor. And in particular, in the case of spin-Hall polarization perpendicular to the easy axis, we got the Y component of the magnetization oscillating at a double frequency due to the trade-off between the spin-Hall polarization and the anisotropy. Well, in this case, let me show that our numerical results were in agreement with the theoretical models firstly presented in the paper by Roman and Professor Slavin, and then adapted to our configuration with perpendicular spin-Hall polarization with respect to the easy axis. I would skip the details of the model, but actually the results were in agreement with our numerical simulations. And finally, I would say at last we can see the detection of terahertz. Well, most of the spin torque diodes, most of the terahertz detectors are based in literatures to the use of the spin orbit torque, like in our device. So like in this paper by Roman, so we decided to continue our collaboration after the first paper with Professor Slavin on the terahertz oscillations, and we calculated the resonance frequency by varying the DC current, but in the sub-threshold regime. And here we can see that as the DC current increases, the AFMR decreases, and that the emission current basically it corresponds to the frequency of the self oscillation in agreement with the model. So we are in the passive regime, and these first results basically allowed us to publish a paper in, last year just based on the passive detection of terahertz, a paper led by Ansar Safin, where we got that through the inverse Spinelli effect, it is possible to convert a terahertz signal into a DC voltage. And the most important aspect here is that the detector can be tuned by means of a very low current. We are indeed in the sub-threshold regime. We got a large value of sensitivity comparable with the Schottky diodes, but a very low quality factor due to the fact that in the sub-threshold regime we have high frequency corresponding to a large bandwidth as shown before. If we want to get a narrower band detection, we can exploit the narrow line width of the oscillation obtained at large current. So in the above threshold regime, and in fact, in, a few months ago, we published this paper where we studied the different configurations of our oscillator, where we got also modulation, pooling, and in particular, locking. In these three cases of DC current, above threshold current, of course, we observed the locking of the oscillation at the terahertz signal with a narrow band detection and a larger quality factor of about 400. So basically, we also expect a larger sensitivity in the active regime as it occurs in ferromagnetic, similar ferromagnetic detectors. This is basically my summary and very short summary, I would say, and conclusion. Thank you for the attention.